I burn for you, burn for me. So kiss me the way that you would if we died tonight, and hold me the way that you would for the final time. Yeah. Whatever may come, somewhere deep inside, there's always this version of you and I. So just kiss me the way that you would if we died tonight.
Kennedy with Kiss Me on BBC Radio Manchester. It's 10:15. Stacey Copeland here with you on The Late Show, and tonight's pseudonym is Peter Jean Hernandez. Correct answers, Will in Bolton. Hi, Will. And Jeff in Harper. Hey, Jeff, I know all about Whitby. I love Whitby. Do you know, I might have to go back there, but I have been loads of times, but then you can't go to Whitby too many times, can you? And plus, there's all of that around, isn't there? Staithes and, you know, I've forgotten all the others now. Raven's Car, Robin Hood Bay, there, they've all just come back to me. It's lovely around there. Scarborough, of course. Might have to do that, Jeff, you know, go back there, because I do love it. Do love a bit of Whitby. And I can take my kayak. Don't really want to take it in the sea, though. Just all, you know what I mean, just fills your boat with water, those waves. Anyway, I'll have a think. But thanks, Jeff, totally agree. Absolutely love Whitby, I do. And thanks, William Bolton, you've got the right answer. Peter Jean Hernandez is the real name, but who are they better known as? What's the stage name? 81333 is the number to text. Start the message with the word Mank. Or you can call Jason on 0800 218 2255. Right, we've got Kiva and Matt with us on the social. Evening, you two.
Hello.
Oh, good evening.
How have you been, Kiva?
Really, really good. I'm very happy because my girlfriend's back from Cyprus now. So
how long was she there for?
10 whole days.
And that's a long time.
It's the longest we've been away from each other. So I spent the whole time at my parents. I came back for a couple of days last week, just so I could be here, but then I went straight back to my parents and then came back, and then I had one night on my own, and I hate it. I just really don't like being on my own. I think I realized these last 10 days how much I need people around me.
Thing is, though, you know, if you do get used to it if you have to.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, because you're with someone, there's a person who you miss.
Yeah.
That you're used to having there. But I live on my own now. Having always lived with people, never lived on my own before. So either lived with my family, obviously, or my whole 20s, I was in America playing football, so I always had housemates who were my teammates, usually three or four, so surrounded by people in my 20s. Yeah, and I've always lived with people, either, you know, boyfriends or whoever. It's the first time I've lived on my own.
Yeah.
And it was weird this year, because it was the first time I've ever woken up on my birthday on my own.
Wow.
Like, what, didn't bother me. Didn't bother me in the slightest. Not one bit. I don't want to wake up on Christmas Day on my own.
Yeah.
There's something about Christmas that, you know, don't quite fancy that, but other than that, it's nice, because I think I see so many. The difference is if you see a lot of people in the day, innit? If you don't see people, that's a bit coming that home to an empty house and you aren't seeing it or being in all day.
Yeah.
But I'm out and about with people all the time because of the nature of the work that I do. So I actually find it quite peaceful when I get home. Yeah. Me and my kayak. Mm-hmm. Quite happy.
In your bedroom.
Rowing in my room, yeah. Oh, it's ridiculous. I need to let it down because it's just taken up. But, you know, when you get used to something, you think, quite like trampling over that on my way to bed and nearly falling on my face in the night when I forget it's there. But yeah, it's gonna
friends,
have to.
Friends, my kayak friends. Yeah. Why has it gone so silent?
Because we thought there was a proper story.
Got a kayak friend.
I've got a kayak friend.
No,
the end. Flipping heck. Thought of writing a book.
I wish.
Matt, what have you been up to?
I've been working on Sexy Beast this week, a couple of days on the production side.
Tell us about that then.
It was a film based in the early noughties with Ray Winston and a couple of big actors. And they're doing a prequel, so it's a series before the film, run by Paramount Plus. So I've just been working in the studio this week doing some practical sparks.
You enjoyed it?
Yeah, it's always good fun working around people that are like-minded and stuff. Obviously with the studio build, you're not actually with the actors at the time, but, you know, I've been to a couple of production days as well, but yeah, it's good fun.
Well, that's all right then, isn't it? I'm a bit, how are you feeling about what feels like winter now?
I love it.
Me too.
Oh, get out. Jason, get these two
I
out.
I can take all...
They just said they love winter.
I can take all Jason seasons don't. As they come. All seasons
We're sunshine
as they come.
People.
No, like the build-up to winter is my favourite. When it's like peak winter time, I'm not too keen.
My wife's been out and bought all the Halloween options and all the rest of it now. It's all starting to come out slightly, bits and bits.
Oh, no.
Big
no.
Halloween party at ours.
See, I hate these dark nights. I came out of the gym on Monday. I've been stuck in all day because I thought I'm going to have to be good and stay in and try and get better, you know, get rid of this cold. So I did, and I like wrapped up, even at soup, like, you know, all the things that you think, this'll work, this'll do it, I'll be right as rain by Tuesday. And, you know, I did boring stuff like invoices for like the other jobs that I do and replied to females, accepted my new 5-year mortgage that's more a month now, but whatever, exciting. That's a whole other story. So I did all that. And then just thought, I've got to go to the gym because I was just well grumpy climbing the walls. So I did. I came out of the gym. It was about 7:30, proper dark. And I thought, oh, no. Honestly, it was just horrible.
It's crazy how quickly you get used to the sunlight as well. Then before you know it, it's pitch black again.
But it's not for me. It's a perfect time for your slow cooker to come back out.
Yes, yes.
Sack the slow cooker.
Me and my wife just got ours out sunlight. Back in the chilli, do you know what I mean? Oh. Nice chilli.
I tell you what, you need to get out, you.
Chilli dogs, lovely.
Oh, I love the autumn slow cooker. Get lost, Matt. Not a chance. Not an absolute chance. Oh, I've got some daybreak suggestions. Hayfield, Peak District, yeah, that's a good one. Great walks and pubs. I'm not a drinker, me, so I don't drink, so pubs have got to have something else other than
the AO
just drinks. It's got to have a good environment and atmosphere and stuff for me. Buxton or Chester, those are good calls, aren't they? Buxton's nice, Chester's lovely.
Chester's lovely, yeah.
Or if you want a bit further, Holy Island, yes, Lindisfarne. That's from Tony. Thank you, Tony. I've been to Lindisfarne when I was about 20. Have either of you been there?
Never heard of it.
No. Ace. You can only get across when the water's like not there.
Oh, right, yeah.
Whatever they call it. There's a name for this. I was talking about this the other week, wasn't I, Jason? How there's...
Causeway.
Is it a causeway? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, yeah.
When the water...
Like, literally disappears.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it covers it, so you just have to stay on the island overnight, and then you can come back the next day when the water's gone.
Hey, you can swim if you want.
On the kayak, yeah.
That's a long way. It's a long way. Yeah. I'm leaving now. Off I go. No, I'm not thinking of going to that adventurous. Not Huckleberry Finn level, but that's what it's called. That's right. I was trying to think of that word. It's great there. So it's got loads of history and stuff
like that. How far away is it from here? How do we get there?
It's about 3 hours. It's northeast. It's quite a drive.
Yeah.
And then obviously have to go over that bit.
Is there like an Airbnb there? Like, how do you...
Yeah, there's loads. Yeah, I stayed in a B&B when I went. Mm. It's unusual little place. I do really like the northeast, the coast and everything, but we were in Newcastle and York last week, so what goes somewhere different. So I'm gonna have to think about that. We're talking about new phrases coming up, but of course Stacey's pseudonym this evening is underway. Peter Jean Hernandez is the name. Who are they better known as? What is their stage name? Will in Bolton's got it correct, and Jeff in Harper Hay. If you want to have a go, the number to text is 81333. Start your message with the word bank, or you can call Jason on 0800 218 2255. If you love winter and you think it's great having these dark nights, don't bother ringing. We don't want to hear from you. Sunshine people only. It's 10:20.
Alan Bezzik's late night phone-in.
You know when you got in Roger Moore's car, did he talk to you?
Yeah, he did. He was very chatty.
Why didn't you say to him, I don't expect you to talk, I expect you to drive?
Because he might have said, then get out. Would have been a good line, wouldn't it?
Now we know where the James Bond films got the Bond villain from. He met you. You were the template.
The Simon template, you might say.
For you, that was reasonably quick.
The name's Bezzik. Alan Bezzik.
Shaken, not stirred.
Saturday and Sunday nights from 10.
BBC Radio Manchester.
Get me now.
ABBA and Mamma Mia, 25 past 10, Stacey Copeland here on The Late Show. I tell you what, I should ask you for suggestions for everything. Good life coaches, aren't you, and suggestion makers? Because I've asked about suggestions for short breaks. I've got 2 days off this month and I want to go away so that I can, you know, don't end up doing stuff. I can actually have a break. So we've had Hayfield, Peak District, Buxton, Chester, Holy Island, and one from Simon. Simon, you know how we always say, like, you know, Bill in wherever, Chorley, and Dave in Manchester. Oh, I can't even think of any great Manchester places suddenly. That's weird, isn't it? I live in one. But anyway, you know how we do that. And Simon, in case you don't know, always says he's in some sort of condition or state or scenario. Tonight, Simon is in a state of suspended animation, which is a belter. Simon, you've outdone yourself there. That's an absolute cracker. That's as good as being in traction. Simon says, I suggest that you take your kayak up the canal for a fortnight. Kept the suspense going there. I didn't know what I was going to say. No, Simon's nice to me. So Simon says, I suggest that you take your kayak up the canal for a fortnight at the Tolmac Arms in Mosley. Oh, do you know what, Simon? That's funny, because my house backs onto the Huddersfield Canal. Isn't that interesting? I'm not going on the canal first time. I need to test it out in water that I wouldn't be too bothered about falling in. I do not want to fall in a canal. I really don't, because it just stinks, doesn't it? I don't mind going in a river or the sea or whatever, falling in. That don't bother me at all, but not the canal. I don't want to fall in the canal. So I want to have a practice first, make sure I can get in and out without falling, and, you know, kayak along without. It's a two-man, you see, so I'll have someone else with me, so I've got to trust that they're going to be stable and steady. But that's a great suggestion, that is, Simon. I mean, mate, who's going to be coming with me, is from Mosley, so he'll probably know the area. So that's a cracking suggestion. Thank you very much. Mandy says, visit Southport and look at the red squirrels. Bearing in mind, Mandy, I'm very frightened of all animals, but squirrels are better for me, because I can look at them and they just run off, don't they? So you see them for a second and they don't come up sniffing you, biting you, licking you, whatever, like other animals. And Blackpool, do you know what, Mandy? I'm a sucker for Blackpool, mate. I absolutely love Blackpool. I went for a day out there for my 40th birthday last year with all my nieces and that. I love it. So that's tempting. Right, well, I'll have a think. Thank you for these suggestions. Really appreciate them. I'm also asking you for Stacey's pseudonym tonight. Peter Jean Hernandez, I'm asking you who they're better known as. What's their stage name? Will in Bolton's got it right. Jeff in Harper Hay, who suggested Whitby, by the way. Patrick in Fallowfield. Hi, Patrick. I think I heard you on Sweeney's Arrows the other day. And he did well. I was well proud of you. Well done. And Malk in Swinton. Hi, Malk. Good evening to you as well. You've got it right. Also, right, Kiva and Matt are with us on the social. I wanted to talk about these new phrases, because the Oxford English Dictionary added 15 new words and phrases ahead of the World Cup starting in November. And some of them included those coined by football managers. So Sir Alex Ferguson and Jose Mourinho. So Ferguson's was squeaky bum time, and it was first said by him in 2003. The description is that they've given in the dictionary a particularly tense period of time, especially one leading up to the climax of a competition or event. What a lovely way to put it. And then Mourinho, his phrase, park the bus, that's made it into the dictionary, described as to play in a very defensive way. So it got me thinking, because I think most families, friendship groups, if you're part of a workplace, a team, you know, a group of people, you tend to get your own phrases, don't you, that either somebody says all the time and then you all use it, or take the fun out of it, whatever, take the mick, or in families, ones that people have used, or ones that you just, I don't know, develop. Mm-hmm. So what phrases, if you had a dictionary that were, you know, that was part of your family group or friends or whatever, what phrases would be in there, and who would you give credit to for them?
Well, I was discussing it with my daughter tonight, and she's got two that she uses quite often. Okay. Or we use them for her to describe right. what we want her to do. Right. One of them is plinky plonky.
Right.
Can you have a guess what it is and what it means?
When what's the context?
Go in toilet.
So it's evening and you're heading to bed.
Go in toilet. Yeah.
How put your plinky plonky on, darling, which is nice, soft, relaxing music. And we call it plinky plonky. Somehow it got the word plinky plonky right. back a couple of years ago. And now
so
she will not go to bed.
Is that to describe quiet music?
Yeah, yeah, for her and herself. Like, right. So she puts like the sounds of the waves or the
that's great,
meditating
that.
Music.
Plinky plonky, though.
But for some reason, the wife's called it plinky plonky and it stuck for a few years.
Right.
And also, when she wants to use YouTube, she calls it eggs. Because eggs? The first time she used YouTube, she was watching these eggs videos, and it was just all about, can I watch eggs? Can I watch eggs?
Right.
And it was all about eggs.
Isn't it amazing so what kids eggs. Pick up? I remember my niece once getting to mum's house, and my sister used to have her Alexa in the kitchen. And my little niece just used to go in every kitchen, everyone's house, and go, Alexa! Like that. And we'd be like, what's she doing? And then we realised, oh, she thinks there's just this magical thing in everybody's kitchen. And you wouldn't even think they'd picked it up. Well, those are great, those. Plinky Plonky. I like Plinky Plonky. Kiva?
I don't have anything as unique as Plinky Plonky. I say all that shebang a lot.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
To describe what? In what context do you use that?
Just when I run out of words to say. So if I'm like...
So is it like something bad or something good?
It could be either or. Ah. So like, it depends on the context. Yeah. If I'm talking about something bad, like, oh, they did all these things and all that shebang, or like, it's just to add onto a list.
Right.
It means like more of this thing.
So do you say it in the same way, whether it's good or bad, so you don't go, it's all shebang?
I think the tone would change.
If it's negative or if it's, oh, shebang,
and
if
all
it's
that
good.
Shebang. It has to be all that shebang and all that stuff. I suppose it's a more polite way of saying, like, less polite things.
Did you get that from Chicago, by any chance?
No, is it from Chicago?
No, but with all that stuff, then.
Oh, I love Chicago.
And all that jazz.
That's my favourite musical.
Have you got any favourite phrases of your own or that family members have ever...
One of my favourites, because my girlfriend Scouse, is, what's that got to do with the price of fish? You know when someone brings
up
a phrase, it's my favourite phrase, because it's so relevant.
I've got, this is dead sad, but I've got a book that I got years ago called the Book of Idioms, and that's what they are. So like, you know, straight out the horse's mouth, or, you know, stuff like that, those are idioms, and they give the explanation of where those idioms came from in
that's
the first
sick.
place. Yeah, so that prize fish one, I'll have a look later.
I'll look
in my idioms book and let you know.
Imagine like,
or we could Google it in a minute.
Imagine being that person that comes up with a new idiom, but no one knows who you are, but obviously someone had to come
imagine
up with
if you could have copyrighted
place. Yeah,
phrases.
What, then you make money every time someone says that?
I know. My granddad used to say, don't cast the clout till May's out.
What
always.
What does that mean?
To say, put a vest on. Just always put, because he used to go, how can you wear vests all the time, granddad? Oh, you've got a vest on, I've got a vest on. He used to go, don't cast the clout. He always used to say it. And that was his explanation for wearing a vest. It's probably not to do with it. Probably just said it. Just used to say daft things all the time.
I love as well, to kill two birds with one stone. But I got really confused one time, and I said to kill one bird with two stones.
That's a bit brutal.
Yeah,
that's a bit harsh,
violent.
Isn't
that's
it?
Just mean.
Yeah.
You're horrible, you, Kiva.
I know, I get really confused sometimes.
Next.
Matt, have you got any favourite ones?
Not really, no. I use stuff all the time for jokes and bits and bobs, like, shut up or smack your face.
Oh,
but it's a really nice saying.
No,
but it's really
I think we've had enough of you two. Thanks a lot. Try to have a nice, chilled out, enjoyable chat here. And there's you two killing birds with a stone and you smashing people's heads in. Right, the security, we've done with these two. Thank you very much. Right, Stacey Sudenham, and I'll give you, I've got Calvin Harris and Rag and Bowman on the way. I'll give you the answer after that. It's Peter Jean Hernandez. If you think you know who that is, who the better known as, so what the stage name is, then please do give us a call on 0800 218225 or text 81333, start your message with the word Mank, and I'll try and keep these two in their cages.
I understood loneliness before I knew what it was. Saw the pills on your table for your unrequited love. Oh, I would be nothing without you holding me up. Now I'm strong enough for both of us. I am a giant.
up on my shoulders, tell me what you see. Cause I am a giant. We'll be breaking borders underneath our feet.
So, Kiva's been coming here on the Late Show, well, on the Dead Good Show before that, for how long? Ages?
I don't know. Long enough.
Quite a while.
Yeah.
And we just got chatting about when I worked at the school. She went to the school where I worked. Yeah. And she was at the school when I worked there.
And I was there for 5 years as well.
That's mad. Mm-hmm. That's absolutely mad. I must have. Did you look different?
I did look very different,
yeah. Yeah, you see, that's the thing sometimes, when people have to conform to a uniform. And they're not allowed their own air and their own this and their own that. They look really different by the time they leave.
Well, you'll remember this. Do you remember when they put in a red line at the front of the school?
Yeah, yeah.
And I used to sneak in my Converse.
Take your coat off.
Yeah, red line. And
it was so that when you come in, that's where you're supposed to then, like, it's so that you can...
Get monitored
in cold weather, it gives you from the front door to the line to take your coat off. So if you're free, no one's going to take off outside if it's pouring down.
Yeah, but
so by the red
line,
you're supposed to have it off and that.
Yeah, in the bags. I put my Converse in my bag and stuff and get changed afterwards. And they put in a massive clock outside the school, right? I remember
this. You had
to be in before 8:38, and then at 8:38 they'd stop you and all the PSMs. They were like the police of the school. They used to sit there and jot your name down. You have to stay for half an hour.
Sounds like a really nice school.
Yeah,
it's like every school's exactly the same.
I think Carswood was a different level. It's a massive school. It's very unique.
It's the biggest in Greater Manchester. So
I think it's the third largest in the UK. Yeah, but I'll have to double check.
Absolutely massive.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. There's not many places you go without people connected to that school. It's amazing, but brilliant community. It really is. I was thinking about those phrases, by the way. Ones that we say all the time in our family, to be fair,
yeah,
we say that loads. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about something, we go, well, yeah, well, to be fair. And then the other one we say that never ever ever precedes anything that's funny is, I'm not being funny, but ever. That means you're about to complain about something. Yeah, well, not being funny, mate, but then, you know, there's a criticism coming or a complaint or something. We use those all the time in our family. Anyway, we've been asking you for Stacey's pseudonym. Peter Jean Hernandez is this evening's. Will in Bolton's got it correct. Jeff in Harper Hay, Patrick in Fallowfield, and Malk in Swinton. And a huge thank you as well to Mandy, Tony and Simon for your suggestions of places that I can go on a break. So you two, do you want to have a guess before I give the answer? Peter Jean Hernandez?
No, and I only just...
Let me give you a clue.
I think he's a singer. I think it's Bruno Mars, is it?
Yes, well done.
Oh, yeah.
Hey.
Well done, Matthew.
Bruno Mars, well done. Thank you, everyone, for joining in with that. We've got the reverse hit coming up after 11 as well that you can get involved with. Right, question of the week. I don't drink hot drinks, apart from the very occasional hot Vimto. But last week at that hotel that I was at in London, I was full of a cold. All I wanted was a bath and a hot Vimto. They didn't have a bath and they didn't have any Vimto. So I went over to where the kettle was, obviously, and I thought there was a peppermint tea. which that's what I thought. I thought, do you know what? I'm going to give it a go. Mm. I actually really liked it.
It's delicious.
I actually bought a pack. Mm. You know. So very sophisticated.
How the other
now.
Style live.
Yeah, I actually sat in my kayak on Monday with a peppermint tea in the bedroom. Lot. Anyway, so I was wondering if there's any food or drinks that you've tried recently, or you know, last couple of years even, that you never thought you'd try and you have. Do you try stuff anyway, or are you quiet?
I try everything.
See, I don't. Yeah. I'm well boring. Mm. Like, I won't try.
It's quite a strict
stuff,
diet to what you eat.
Yes, yeah. That's maybe why that I don't remember, because the thing is, trying things isn't a big deal for me. Half my family are French, right? So we eat weird things. And I remember I remember the last time I tried something that really blew. It's not even that weird. It was a squid ink spaghetti.
Oh.
It was delicious. It was amazing. I had it in Portugal. Yeah, it was
so
gorgeous.
I've just come back from a holiday with the family, and I've been trying to be a bit more open with my food, and fish seems to be the one that I've never really touched. Any type of fish. Mm. I did have a black squid risotto.
Oh, what?
And it was really, really nice.
No,
it gave me blackjack mouth, but it was really, really nice.
That's you two, honestly. Aggressive, minging, don't know what else. I tell you what, when we're in Japan, at the we trained for the World Championships in boxing at the Japanese, the Olympic Centre. When we got up in the morning, the first morning, because you never know what you're going to get.
Quite varied.
You never, ever know. It was fantastic, because for everything, they had all the nutritional details, like, down to the letter, like, yeah. What macros were in it, what micros were in it, everything. Which, when you're a boxer, you're interested in and all of that. Anyway, we were just, like, looking for yogurt or something, you know, muesli or something we recognised. And they actually had stuff like octopus and squid.
Mm. For breakfast?
In a big, yeah.
That
yes.
was alive.
I mean, I can't cope with that in the evening, but when I've just got up,
fishy.
Oh, honestly, absolutely
I
grim.
I ate chicken feet once.
What does it taste Chinese. Like, squid?
Onion rings, squid? Yeah,
not
like,
much.
Onion rings.
Yeah,
it's right. not
That's
actually.
What I
don't really. I don't eat them either, but I can imagine the texture in that.
It's the texture probably that throw you off. The taste in itself isn't that bad. Just like with most fish, I feel the smell is much more potent than what it actually tastes like.
That's true.
When I went to Portugal, I remember. Because by the beach you have like fish barbecues, and they bring out all the fish they caught that day, and I had the cheek of one of the fish, and apparently it was like a delicacy. Mm. And it was the softest bit of fish I've ever eaten. It literally melted in my mouth. It was beautiful. It was good.
Taking it back to a normal
can't handle this, me.
Red wine. I'd never been introduced to red wine before. My wife and her family, that's their go-to drink. Mm. Little did I know, you're not meant to drink it like lager.
No.
Right. So it take you a while to like.
I was not in a good place the next morning.
I bet. Yeah, I bet.
Wine is lethal.
But it was really nice. I got used to it over time, and now I can drink a different variants of Shiraz, Melbach, and you know a few.
Now, don't show
ones.
Off, Matt. It's funny. It's funny though, the different thing, because in Korea when we went boxing there, we didn't eat out and about. We just ate at the hotel, because you do have to be really careful. It sounds daft, but some countries they pump their animals with steroids, which then if you consume them, you know, obviously we get drug tested and stuff. So you have to be really, really careful, and our nutritionist would usually go and test stuff at the hotel and all that. Anyway, outside a lot of the restaurants, they'd have like various fish and sea creatures, and you could pick. Like,
I'll have that.
I'll have him. Yeah,
quick, catch it, catch
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah. I couldn't. Me being me, could not even walk past those fish tanks. I'd be like every single time. Proper lightweight like that. I'm right. Coming up, we're talking about procrastinating, because there's something that I just have not got finished, which you can probably guess what it is. But I'll tell you, and I want your advice on if you're procrastinating. What do you do? How do you get over the line? Get it finished and think, right, I'm going to be disciplined and get this done. That's coming up. We'll get some advice off Kiva and Matt on that coming up after this from Queen. Another One Bites the Dust. It's 10:45. You're listening to The Late Show on BBC Radio Manchester with Stacey Copeland.
Let's go! Walks barely down the street with the pool way down low. Ain't no sound but the sound of his feet. Machine guns ready to go. Are you ready? Hey, are you ready for this? Are you hanging on the edge of your seat? Out of the doorway, the bullets rip to the sound of the beat, yeah. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone, and another one gone. Another one bites the dust, yeah. Hey, I'm gonna get you too. Another one bites the dust.
And another one bites the dust, 13 minutes away from 11 on the late show. Now I wanted to talk about procrastinating because I got loads of work done on my house to get it to a point where I could move in, but the last few months I've hardly done anything, and that was my plan in a way, because for quite a few months I was doing this, the late show and school, impossible to do anything else. Then when I finished school in August, I just wanted August off because I didn't get any summer last year at all. I was in the house all the time because there was so much to do. I had to be. So all those nice days I was in, like grouting and tiling and doing all that. So I thought I need a summer this year. So this year I've enjoyed, you know, some bike rides out, going out, you know, open water swimming, all of that lot. And obviously I've been here at the night time, but, you know, I've tried to make the most of it. But suffice to say, nothing's got done in my house. So that's, you know, it does need doing. So I was wondering, first of all, so that I know I'm not on my own, what are the things that you tend to put off doing the most? What do you procrastinate on most?
It's finishing the job. I don't mind getting a job started. I'm quite good at getting it started, getting it underway and stuff. It's just them final details at the end. Like I was telling you about my media wall, it took me 3-4 days to get it done to a good point. And then I'm still 2 years down the line, or a year and a half, and I've not done my skirting boards.
Right.
Just because I can't get around. I just don't get that incentive to just finish it off, because it looks great. Until you look down to the bottom section and you're like, oh, it could just do with finishing off.
You just kind of get used to stuff as well, don't you?
Yeah.
Like my kayak in the bedroom. That'll be me in 12 months. I thought of deflating it, but you know.
Not took it out once yet.
I know.
I'm with Matthew on this, yeah, defo. Like when I find the energy to do something, I'll plow like hours into it, especially when my mind really likes something. It's usually art or music. But then when it gets to the end, like finessing things, just putting the finishing touches, usually that's when I'll lose a bit of motivation.
See, that's what I was like with my house. I got like my kitchen, you know, absolutely flew through that, my bathroom, the bedroom, you know, the essentials in order to move in. And it's just those things that aren't essential, like the two downstairs
that you can
rooms.
Kind of tuck away, yeah.
Yeah. That, well, it's not really tucked away, it's all over the floor.
but just lives upstairs for now.
What are the words of advice then for getting stuff done? What do you do when you really need to finish something or even start something? When you've put it off, what do you do to get it done?
I've got two phrases for you. Use your own mind to think about things rather than think of them. So actually get your mind into action and get them done. Or you can fool everyone else, but you can't fool your own mind. So just, you know, just keep cracking on with what you need to do, because at the end of the day, it's only you that's going to be disappointed when you don't get through to the end, basically.
That's true.
That was really sound advice. That was really good advice, yeah.
Don't know if I understood it, but it's basically saying get on with it, innit?
Yeah.
In two different ways,
In an intellectual way. Right, go on then, Kiva.
I would say my main advice is when you have that little brief moment of, could I do something right now? Take advantage of it, because it's in those moments that you really need to push yourself. So when you do that 5 minutes of cleaning, just do an extra 10 minutes and really take advantage of those little outbursts of energy that you have, because once they're gone, they're gone. At least I can only speak for myself. Once I lose the energy, I'll wait 2-3 days.
That's a good point. Yeah. I need the motivation to get it finished. Mm-hmm. And I think, and the time.
Yeah.
Because see, the jobs that I've got left now are not short things, the things that you need a good few hours for, and I just don't get that in. Yeah. That. I mean, I did Monday, but that was supposedly resting to, and then I had a load of paperwork to do anyway. So I think once I get this really busy couple of weeks out of the way, December will be a lot quieter for me.
Yeah.
It'll be rubbish weather outside anyway, and I won't mind being stuck in doing it. So do you know what'll happen though? I'll get one day where I've got the day off, and I always panic about days off, me. Don't know about you, but I always go, oh, I've got a day off, what am I going to do? I've got nothing to do. I always think, oh, I'm too busy. Then I get a day off and have a massive panic because I think, oh, what am I going to do with the day off?
Bit of a brain fart.
Yeah, so, but what'll happen is I'll get one and I'll get up and I'll think, right, today is the day, and I'll just like plough through it. I reckon that's what's going to happen. The final thing I wanted to talk about was because today is World Teachers' Day. It commemorates the anniversary of the adoption of the 1966 UNESCO recommendation on the status of teachers, which set benchmarks regarding the rights and responsibilities of teachers. Da, da, da. Anyway, we all just call it World Teachers' Day, and we appreciate all the people and the teachers who've made a difference to us. So, of course, I wanted to ask which teachers have made a difference to you at any point in your life. That can be later on. It can be when you're at school as a kid. Tell me about them.
So, actually, funnily enough, one of them was Miss Growark, my music teacher in high school. I absolutely loved her, and not just because she got me out a lesson to do music, but because she actually understood how passionate I was about music, and she took me seriously, and she got me on to do choir for Manchester United, and we were just really close. She had an amazing relationship with all of the
music
students.
She really did. She's an outstanding human being as well.
Insane. And my Spanish teacher was also, but she was kind of a different ball game. She was very scary.
Who was that?
She was called Miss McVeigh.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I got an A star in Spanish all because of Miss McVeigh, because she used to scare me so much.
Yeah, Scouser.
Proper Scouser. And you'd literally, so class would start at 125, but you couldn't get there at 123.
No,
because you'd
be
walking through the door and she'd be like, why are you lace?
Yeah, like, straight on it, yeah. Know. No, she played hardball, she did. And were you in any of the school plays? Because Hannah Growack used to put
plays.
On the best school plays
in
ever.
In Chicago. I've
got to have seen you loads of times, because I brought my niece to see all of the school plays for like years because they were brilliant. They were like,
I love them. They were
honestly
amazing.
Matt, they were like, you'd gone to, you'd paid to, right, well, yeah, you did pay like a small amount to that went to the PTA or whatever, but you'd have bought a proper ticket to go and see it. The kids were phenomenal in it, and that's what she put together. They were just superb.
It was insane.
Chicago was excellent. It was one of the really
Chicago.
Good ones.
Yeah,
and Annie.
Oh, I don't think I did, Annie.
Didn't you?
I don't think I was there. No,
that
I didn't do
really
the show
good.
In year 11. That's when I stopped doing shows.
Yeah, GCSEs. So, yeah. Bummer. Ruins everything. All right, well, those are great ones. Matt?
I can't remember as well as Kiva.
Yeah, well, I was...
Because she left in 2015, I left in 1998. But I do remember Mrs. White. She was a religious studies teacher, but she was also a drama teacher on the side and did bits and bobs. And she was the one teacher you could go to with a problem, an issue or whatever. She was this tiny little dot. Nothing about her at all, but she was the biggest personality that you'd need at the time, or the sweetest lady at the same time. I was quite a good student until year 9, and then I started to become a bit more of a bloke and a bit more of a whatever, and she just always put me in my place, always told me the right words of wisdom at the right time, and you could just never frown upon it. You could never say you're wrong, because she was always right, but she always did it in the best way. I got suspended a few times for what it was, but she taught me never to get suspended for the same thing. Never get told off.
That's a good plan.
For doing
it
again.
Very misbehaviour.
But she was one of them teachers where you could have even a cig with her on the snide, somewhere around the corner or something. But not to tell her that, because I think she's still working at her now, to be honest, at Harrytown. But she was just one of them grade A teachers that you'd never forget about.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that they used to do back in the day that they couldn't do now. I mean, at one time, teachers smoked in the classroom, didn't they? That was like perfectly acceptable. Of course, it isn't now. So, well, thanks for sharing those with us. And happy World Teachers' Day to all the teachers out there at all levels and, you know, age groups and all the things that you do, because they do make a massive difference, and often don't even know the difference they've made until much later, if at all they find out. Right, you two, it's been a real pleasure. What are you up to the rest of the week, Kiva?
I'm going to chill out with my girlfriend this weekend. Tomorrow I'm going to see my brother, who's back from Italy. He's been gone for a month, and we're going to go to Big Hands Chill out. But the weekend, I'm just going to chill out with my girlfriend. Probably have a bath.
Ace, Matt.
I'm just going to follow the world football this weekend, see what's going on. Obviously, we got a drumming by City at the weekend, Haaland and young Foden doing their business. But hopefully, we can turn it around tomorrow. We've got a European game. I know it's not the Champions League, but.
And it's just, something.
Yeah, it's better than nothing. And just see how that goes this weekend.
Absolutely. You too. Thank you so much, Kiva and Matt, for being with us on the social. Really, really appreciate it. Have a brilliant weekend. Coming up after the news at 11, we've got a brand new reverse hit for you, plus my special guest, Peter Hayes. We heard from him about 3 weeks ago when he was preparing to cycle from London.